Good morning, or good evening, as the case may be, and greetings from Chicago. I am Sister Barbara Reed, Carol Stuhlmuller Professor of New Testament Studies and President of Catholic Theological Union at Chicago. CTU is a sponsor of this annual lecture, along with the Archdiocese of Chicago, AJC Chicago, Anti-Defamation League, Chicago Board of Rabbis, DePaul University, Jewish Federation of Metropolitan Chicago, and the Spertus Institute for Jewish Learning and Leadership. It is my great pleasure to welcome you to our 2021 Joseph Cardinal Bernardin Jerusalem Lecture. I would like to begin by inviting us to pause for a moment of silent prayer as we pray for peace in Jerusalem. Before we begin our program, we want to invite you to submit questions for His Beatitude, Patriarch Pizzaballa, by using the Ask Questions feature at the bottom of your screen. We will try to pose as many of your questions as we can, as time permits, following his lecture. And now, I would like to share some of the story of Catholic-Jewish relations in Chicago and Northeastern Illinois, which reaches a historic moment in the man after whom the lecture series is named, Joseph Cardinal Bernardin. As we gather online today from Chicago to Jerusalem and many points in between, we would do well to remember the words of Pope John Paul II, who said in 1995, quote, "As we look to the future, there is an urgent need for us to continue building on the foundations already laid. One of our greatest mutual challenges remains at the level of education and information, where the results of our cooperation must ultimately be implemented. If it is to be fruitful, dialogue between Christians and Jews must find eloquent expression in the life of both our communities." End quote. Joseph Cardinal Bernardin is the best example of building on the foundations already laid. And the late and much beloved Rabbi Herman Shalman, Rabbi Emeritus of Temple Emmanuel and visiting professor at several seminaries in Chicago, affirmed, quote, "Spirit and concrete implications of Nostra Aetate, confirmed and elaborated by the popes and other church leaders, none more forthrightly than Cardinal Joseph Bernardin," end quote. Chicago has been a privileged place for dialogue. In 1893, during the World's Fair, the first Parliament of the World's Religions was held and created a critical shift in social consciousness. America entered the 1893 Parliament thinking of itself as a Protestant nation. It emerged understanding itself as a nation of Protestants, Catholics, and Jews. In 1993, the second Parliament in Chicago, America came to know itself as a multi-religious nation. In between, there were significant immigrations, such that Chicago's Jewish and Catholic populations grew rapidly in the 1920s. In fact, Chicago would become the city with the third largest Jewish population in the world. The two communities would build strong, mediating institutions of parishes, synagogues, community centers, and protective organizations, building a capacity for engagement. The civil rights movement in the late 1950s brought Jews and Christians together in common cause for justice and equality, something still called for today. We came to know each other from engaging in what Pope Francis has called a duty of service. All of these foundations were in place when in 1982, Joseph Cardinal Bernardin became the Archbishop, pardon me, not Cardinal yet in 1982, he became the Archbishop of Chicago. And from the public event celebrating the anniversary of Nostra Aetate at Mundelein College, a number of unique and successful efforts developed. These included priest and rabbi retreats, local lay dialogue groups, the founding of the Council of Religious Leaders, the Scholars Dialogue under Sister Joan McGuire with the Chicago Board of Rabbis and the JCRC, the Institute for Catholic Jewish Education by Sister Anna Marie Erst and Sister Mary Ellen Coombe with AJC, and also the Center for the Study of Eastern European Jewry at Spertus, the establishment of the Catholic Jewish Studies Program at Catholic Theological Union, the Women's Dialogue Groups, and a joint publishing project with Liturgy Training Publications. This was the context that inspired Cardinal Bernardin to travel to the Holy Land in 1995, accompanied by leadership of our Jewish partner organizations and Catholics who worked with them. The centerpiece of what came to be called the dialogue visit to Israel, the West Bank, and Gaza was the attempt to see and experience through the eyes of the other, the land, which is holy to both of our communities. Cardinal Bernardin delivered the first Jerusalem lecture entitled Antisemitism, the Historical Legacy and Continuing Challenge for Christians in Senate Hall of Hebrew University. The following year, he began the Jerusalem lecture series to continue to study together, build relationships, and see through each other's eyes. In the 25 years which followed Cardinal Bernardin's death in 1996, Cardinal George and now Cardinal Supich have faithfully continued to build on these foundations. Originally, Cardinal Supich planned to travel to Jerusalem and Bethlehem in March of 2020 with a Jewish and Catholic delegation to honor the original dialogue visit and to enhance our local relationship. Tragically, the COVID-19 pandemic made that impossible. However, as we planned to have a memorial lecture 1 year ago, it is fitting that today we receive greetings from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, which was again to have been the venue for the Archbishop of Chicago to speak about Catholic-Jewish relations. Cardinal Supich will make remarks of his own to mark the anniversary and the next steps. But for now, I want to invite the Chancellor of Hebrew University to offer remarks. Professor Menachem Ben Sasson is the 13th president of the Hebrew University of Jerusalem and is in his second 4-year term. He is a tenured professor and researcher in the Department of History of the Jewish People in the Faculty of the Humanities. Before his appointment as president of the university in 2009, he served as a member of the Knesset and as chairman of its Constitution, Law, and Justice Committee. From 2012 to 2015, Professor Ben Sasson served as chairman of the Council of Presidents of the Universities in Israel. It gives me great pleasure now to welcome Professor Menachem Ben Sasson, the Chancellor of the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, to this year's Bernardin Lecture.
Thank you very much for this kind introduction, Sister Reed. I understand congratulations are in order upon your recent and well-deserved appointment to the presidency of the Catholic Theological Union. Thank you also for the inspiring history of His Eminence Joseph Cardinal Bernardin and his legacy, which resonates through the present times with his message of unity, understanding, and peace between peoples. We greatly appreciate your concern about the present situation in Israel and join you in prayers for peace. In these difficult circumstances in which we are now in the Holy Land, it's just appropriate that we open with a prayer, a few verses from Psalms 122nd. I read it in Hebrew and then in English. Shalu shalom Yerushalayim, Yishlayu ohavayich, Yehi shalom b'cheilech, shalva bar menotayich, Neman achai v'reai, adobrana, shalom bach. Pray for the well-being of Jerusalem. May those who love you be at peace. May there be well-being within your ramparts, peace in your citadels. For the sake of my keen friends, I pray for your well-being. The idea of the Hebrew University, dear colleagues, was conceived in the late 19th century, almost in the time of the World Fair in Chicago, as the Jewish people came to realize the great need for Jewish state. In 1925, the university was dedicated in the presence of the Jews, Christians, and Muslims, and was declared as the university of the Jewish people, not the university of the Jews or Jewish university. In the same breath, the university declared its policy from the time of its inception to include all who wish to receive an academic education, regardless of religion, nationality, race, or gender. The university was founded 23 years prior to the founding of the State of Israel, and it serves as primary cornerstone of the newly established country, nowadays known as Startup Nation. So in many ways, the Hebrew University is the startup of the Startup Nation. Many of Israel's leaders were faculty or students of the Hebrew University, and this holds true the present times. In the 5 meetings that I had with the current Pope, first on the ground of the Hebrew University, the first step that he laid on in Jerusalem were at the Hebrew University, and later on paying 4 visits, he always keeping, repeating, and mentioning the importance of education, the fulfillment of the message of equal education to everybody as a message for universe, for university, and for anything that has to do with mission of educators, spiritual educators worldwide. I was privileged to witness in 1995 the ceremony in Mount Scopus campus in the Senate Hall, during which His Eminence Joseph Cardinal Bernardin, Archbishop and Archdiocese of Chicago, was awarded an honorary fellowship. It was moving. It was a moment that we didn't know at that time will be a historical moment, opening new venue, maybe even new highway, to mutual relations between the Hebrew University and Christian world in many ways, as I'm going to show. This honor and subsequent founding by the late Cardinal Bernardin of the annual Jerusalem scholarly lecture were important milestones in our university's history. First, because they represented the strong bond between the Archdiocese and the Jewish community of Chicago, which the added link of the Hebrew University located in both religions' sacred city. Second, the lecture itself is an important event in the university calendar, marking the relationship between Roman Catholicism and Judaism, about which there is no such to be said as we can learn from scholars of these two religions and their connections. In today's very divisive times, we see an increased need to focus on the positive and blessed connection between our two religions. Tabe University cherishes these connections, and indeed, as I said, afterwards in 1999, just prior to His Holiness John Paul's second historical visit to Israel, it founded the Center for the Study of Christianity, unique among Israeli universities, unique by the fact that we teach in all Christian languages the original texts. In recent years, we also founded a Center for the Study of Multiculturalism and Diversity, which promotes understanding between peoples of different religions, ethnicities, cultures, with language classes, dialogue, and seminars. The university itself is an island of harmony, we believe, in a challenging reality where education and research are conducted in a peaceful, inclusive atmosphere. I feel sure that the Cardinal Bernardin would be pleased to witness the university's activities after his visit in the present time. And we feel that he is with us in spirit and in many ways responsible for these very positive changes in our campuses. Although we are still emerging from a very difficult period of the pandemic, I look forward to better days in the near future when we will be able to meet in person. In particular, we are looking forward to the 25th anniversary of Jerusalem Lecture, which will be held at times when we can safely host all of you at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem on Mount of Olives. Welcome to Jerusalem.
Thank you so much, Professor Bensasson. And now I have the honor and the privilege of introducing someone who needs no introduction. Since becoming the Archbishop of Chicago in 2014, he has given a great deal of his time, his presence, and his voice to fostering Catholic-Jewish relations and to opposing anti-Semitism whenever it raises its ugly head. It is my pleasure to introduce to you one of the foremost supporters of Catholic-Jewish dialogue, His Eminence Cardinal Blaise Supich, the Archbishop of Chicago. Cardinal Supich.
Well, good morning, or I should say good afternoon to all of you. It's good to be with you today. And I was pleased that there were prayers for the peace of Jerusalem. And we need to keep in mind that today in our tradition in the Catholic Church, we also mark a very violent moment with the 40th anniversary of the attack on John Paul II. And so maybe it's good for us to voice a prayer for the peace in Jerusalem, but also peace in the world. God of all creation, Father of us all, our faith is your saving help. Protect us from those who would sow violence. Keep us safe from the weapons of hate. Prompt us to promote a just and lasting peace in the world so that all people may have an equal share at the table of life and live securely in a place they call home. May this prayer offering restore tranquility and peace. We ask this in your name and for your glory. Amen. Again, it is a great joy that I join you for this 25th annual Joseph Cardinal Bernardin Jerusalem Lecture. It's good to be with you, even knowing that we would prefer to be together in person. Yet I'm grateful that we can connect virtually from our own homes and workplaces. As we mark 25 years since Cardinal Bernardin initiated this lecture series at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, the longevity and fruitfulness of this event stand as a wonderful testament to our joint commitment as Jews and Catholics in Chicago to learn together and grow in mutual understanding and respect. The first quarter century of this series has laid a deep and meaningful foundation for the next 25 years, primarily because of the collaborative efforts of our partner organizations, which Sister Barbara Reed mentioned earlier. I want to thank all of you for your great work in making today's gathering possible. And I look forward to continuing our partnership well into the future. In particular, I want to thank President Gabriel Esteban of DePaul University and his staff for generously hosting this online lecture. You know, it has been a difficult year, unprecedented in many ways. Let me begin by offering my condolences and prayers to those who have lost loved ones because of the pandemic and to those who are or have been ill with COVID-19. Your sufferings have been great. Please know that you are not alone in this pain. Unfortunately, the pandemic is not over. So I urge all of those listening today to get the vaccine when it becomes available to you. We need to do this together. Please continue to practice the preventative measures that our health experts are advising so that we can minimize the deadly impact of this virus and help bring the pandemic to an end. Our common good and the health and safety of our family, friends, and neighbors depend on our sound choices. As many of you know, we originally planned to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the Joseph Cardinal Bernardin Jerusalem Lecture as part of a dialogue visit to the Holy Land with the leadership of our Jewish and Catholic sponsoring partners. Like Cardinal Bernardin and the 1995 delegation, we planned to visit various holy sites, tour the Yad Vashem, and meet with local religious leaders in Jerusalem and Bethlehem, including our speaker today, Patriarch Pizzaballa. I was really set and looking forward to coming to Jerusalem to offer the Jerusalem lecture at Hebrew University in March of 2020. And we are looking forward to learning about one another together in the land that we both hold especially dear. To postpone that trip at the last minute was indeed painful for all of us. Reflecting on that difficult but correct decision brings two things in mind. First, the ongoing physical suffering of the COVID-19 pandemic remains linked to its economic impact. Tonight's speaker comes to us from Jerusalem, a treasured place of pilgrimage for Jews, Christians, and Muslims, and others. Pilgrimages, study trips, and vacations have largely stopped due to appropriate safety precautions. This reality has adversely affected those who rely on tourism to Jerusalem, Bethlehem, Galilee, and a host of religious and cultural sites in Israel and the Palestinian territories for their livelihood. Know that all of you impacted by this difficult situation are in our thoughts and in our prayers. This concern brings me to a second point. Let me take the opportunity today to state my personal commitment to travel to the Holy Land with our Jewish and Catholic partners for a dialogue visit when it is advisable to do so. I look forward to that day when we can travel as a delegation to strengthen our deep and abiding relationship in Chicago and renew this lecture series at Hebrew University. I hope that this day arrives soon and that the economic livelihood and lifeblood that tourism provides for Jews, Christians, and Muslims, and everyone in the Holy Land, resume as quickly as possible. Before turning the screen over, as it were, to our esteemed lecturer, I'd like to offer one final thought, posed as a question. As the light at the end of this COVID-19 tunnel ever so slowly emerges and becomes bright, it strikes me that we personally and communally have forever been changed during this time. While in no way intending to minimize the untold suffering wrought by the pandemic or the difficulties that have come with the changes that we have seen, I find myself increasingly hopeful these days. I marvel at the creative and productive ways we have found to connect with one another during this trying time. We have somehow found ways to worship and pray and dialogue together while remaining physically distant. Today's lecture is just another example of our profound human resiliency. In light of Pope Francis's modeling of dialogue, let me end with an invitation to consider how we might intentionally commit to encounter, to accompany, and to build friendship with one another through a greater awareness of our ability to connect virtually across continents and our local communities. How can we use these resources for good, to foster peace and harmony, and dispel misunderstandings and hate as we do so? How will we live out the Jewish-Catholic relationship post-pandemic, knowing our communities have forever been changed? I don't have all the answers to this question, but I look forward to working with all of you to seek them together. Thank you for your time. Our speaker today is well known to all of you, so I won't take undue time sharing his extensive biography. I trust I speak for everyone, and I say that we are looking forward to hearing your reflection today on the topic Jewish-Catholic Dialogue, Western and Middle East Views. And so it is my honor to introduce the 25th annual Joseph Cardinal Bernardin Jerusalem Lecture, His Beatitude Patriarch Pierbattista Pizzaballa, Latin Patriarch of Jerusalem.
Thank you, Your Eminence, and thank you for this invitation. I will be short and I'll try to go to the point. I have to say, first of all, that I wrote this text a few days ago, much before the recent explosion of violence here in all Holy Land. And so I feel that I should update a little bit because things changed a little bit. We cannot talk about the Jewish Catholic dialogue, at least here in the Middle East, there's nothing is happening in these days. But anyway, so I will summarize, if you allow me, the first part of my presentation, the Western world, and then I will focus a little more about our situation here in Middle East, especially in Israel. Now, the Western world, first of all, Jewish Catholic dialogue in general. We have ever present in the old and continuous the same challenges, and also we have new challenges, ever present challenges, and something else. Unfortunately, anti-Semitism remains a common commitment towards which everyone must express themselves clearly and without hesitation to condemn, to monitor, and of course also to educate. So we have to be very clear on this. Any form of anti-Semitism and anti-Judaism, which is not exactly anti-Semitism, but anti-Semitism, anti-Judaism, all this attitude has to be absolutely and jointly condemned. And this should be our common commitment, of course. Thanks God for us Catholics now is more clear about our responsibility as Catholic in the past, toward all our relations with the Jewish people. And this make us more committed and more clear also on the places, in some places still, some Catholic communities that can have still some anti-Semitic attitudes or anti-Judaic attitude. So we have to be very clear on this and condemn to this. I think right now the Catholic Church is very, at all level, very clear committed on this. We have to say also, I'm very happy to see that in the last years, especially, I noticed this, especially with the rise of ISIS, the Jewish community has been also very strong, very clear in condemning any form of anti-Christian attitudes and all any form of violence against all minorities, not only Christians, but anyone else, all the minorities, any kind of violence with a religious background. And also was very clear the commitment on the Jewish side in recognition, for instance, of the terrible Armenian genocide and so on. So, I mean, the role of, I think on this, this is very clear common commitment. And unfortunately, we have to still work together along in order to condemn, but also to monitor it, to educate, to have different attitude. It is also more clear for us Catholics that the Jewish is not a Judaism is not a religion of the past. Sometimes in the, for us, this is, was common, but Judaism is a living religion with its own identity, and that should be not obscured or exploited. Another important point is that we should see Jews and Judaism for what they are, for themselves. Quite often I heard, I remember my theological studies, we kept asking ourselves, what is the role of the Judaism or the Jews in our theological reflection? I'm not sure that the Jews want to have a role in our theological reflection, but we have to see them and to approach them for what they are, for themselves. Of course, there are, and the president of the Hebrew University mentioned also a lot of common initiatives in the Christian and Catholic universities. There are Center for Jewish Studies. At Hebrew University, we have Center for Christian Studies. So this is a very clear element that shows us that things are progressing very positively among us. On the other hand, we have also to say that there is a certain fatigue in the Jewish Catholic dialogue right now. Some is due, one of the reasons is that the major leaders of the Jewish Catholic dialogue, as Cardinal Bernardin and others, and also among Jews, are not with us anymore. And so the generation passage is not always easy on this. But also I have to say that sometimes, and more sometimes, the dialogue between Jews and Catholics remains on a kind of, based on political correctness. We talk about, we have generic declaration of friendship that not affect really our life. So it became something maybe closing the circles, universities, that, but not always affect really our life or the life of our respective communities. Another aspect is that unfortunately, politics enters sometimes also in this. For instance, the policy of the State of Israel is perceived by some not as the policy of the Israelis, but as the policy of the Jews. This attitude is becoming quite common in some secular circles, but also among some Catholic movements. And also the dialogue with Muslims is perceived as more important than the dialogue with Jews. And of course, so these are points of discussion. I mean, we have to think about this. We cannot only talk about how friends we are, but we have also to raise some points. So we should refresh the Jewish-Catholic dialogue. And also, since we are friends, we love each other, we can also talk about not only what is common to us, but also what is different from us. We have differences among us, of course. And to talk this in friendship, serenely, I think can bring also to a dialogue among us new fresh area, if I may say. And I think also it's important. Other topic, I want to be, I want to close this. Other important topic, not quite new, but anyway, becoming very evident on the Jewish Catholic dialogue is that we have new challenges, new topic to talk about that are common to both of us, both of our communities. that affects the life of our respective communities, both on a personal level, ethical level, and also at the social level. For instance, the gender theories, artificial intelligence, international economic dynamics, the work market, commitment to justice and peace, very, very important for us here in the Middle East, the relationship between culture, identity, and religion. All these topics, we don't discuss so much about these topics, but are topics that affect the life of our communities, respective communities, and the dialogue among us on these topics can help us also to face this topic together, to have some common stand, or also to evidence the difference among us. The increasingly secular and secularized thought of our society poses many challenges to religious thought, not only with regard to the vision of man and family, but also in the economic and social spheres. The idea of person, of individual rights, personal choice, increasingly widespread in the Western world, are progressively distant from the religious thought, both Christian and Jewish. I think it is necessary to engage in critical, but at the same time, serene and positive dialogue in these instances. If on one hand, it is not possible to uncritically accept all the demands of modernity in this area, on the other hand, it is not even possible to limit oneself to expressing rejection or condemnation, because this will create barrier among us to secular and religious world. And in this, as I repeat, the dialogue between us, Jews and Catholic, can help us to find at least the proper language, how to address this issue as religious in a critical way, but also positive and constructive way. And also the topic of religion and identity is very common, especially in Europe. I don't know in the United States, to have religion without faith, to use religion to mark, to use religion as instrument of element of identity to define our identity, even if you are not a believer. And quite often this is used by some political movements and is used also against Muslim, against all the other diverse reality in our societies. And we have to avoid all this. And at the same time, to avoid this manipulation. At the same time, religion is also part of the identity. So how to relate these topics in a proper positive way. Pope Francis, also with the two letters, Laudato Si and Fratelli Tutti, has initiated an important dialogue in order to rethink the economic, the social, political, even religious models that have guided us up to now, but which at present manifest their weakness. So this is also very, very important. Another important topic, we cannot talk among us without a clear common stand, common commitment for justice and peace. And it is not always granted, of course. So these are just very shortly, I summarized in my broken English, some topics that are common to in all the different realities, especially in the Western world. But now I want to focus a little more about Israel, where I live. I live in Jerusalem since 30 years. I was also a student at Hebrew University many years ago. When Cardinal Bernardin was in Hebrew University, I was a student there, but I was not part of any, I was just at the beginning. Anyway, in the Middle East, and particularly in Israel, I read now, the situation is very different from that in Western world. While in the West, Judaism and Catholicism are more or less autonomous with respect to political life, in Israel, it is the opposite. Official Jewish religion institutions are part of the political life of the country, where Christianity is a minority and Judaism is a majority, it's a unique case. Policy plays a dominant role in relationship. In a way, I think that the Jewish community abroad have more freedom in their dialogue with the Catholicism than the local Jewish institutions. Because here the local Jewish institutions are also in a way connected with the political activities, and they have to relate also to their people who not always have a positive attitude of the Christians. Although, as mentioned above, the Jewish Catholic dialogue has made great strides from Nostra Aetate up to today, it must be recognized that in the Middle East, we are still at the beginning of our journey. This is due, in all honesty, to the reluctance of both parties involved. On the part of Christian churches, largely Arab, there is an objective difficulty in understanding how much knowledge of Judaism and dialogue with religious Israel are fundamental for Christian life. Obviously, this is mainly due to political reasons. For the churches of the Middle East, in fact, it is difficult to distinguish between the religious and political Israel, and there is a certain reluctance, or maybe fear, to publicly dialogue with Judaism for fear of being accused of collaborationism by the Arab population. And this is very evident in these days. Unfortunately, in these days, we have in mixed cities of Israel, Haifa, Jaffa, where Jews and Arabs live together. To talk with Jews now, to have some common attitude with the Jews is seen as, but also from the Palestinians in Palestine and the Palestinian authorities, seen as a concession to the enemy. So it's very difficult, since most of the faithful of the church are Arab, it's very difficult for the church to have this free access and public access to initiative to Jews here in Holy Land, in Israel. The gestures of rapprochement between Jews and Catholics are thus seen as political gestures and as a submission to politicalism. On the other hand, there is not much interest, we have to recognize, in dialogue with the local Catholicism at Jewish religious institutions in Israel. There is a Council for Religious Dialogue with Judaism, I'm part of it, I'm a member of it, but it does not have much influence on the general public. In the Holy Land, the Israeli-Palestinian political question, rightly or wrongly, is considered the reason for the aforementioned reticence. It does not allow a truly free dialogue between the two sides. The absence of Jews at the interreligious meeting in Iraq between Pope Francis and the Imam Sistani exemplifies this situation at the general level in the Middle East. It is true that we had the Abraham Accords, but at the at the population level, there is still the attitude toward Jews and Judaism, especially Israel, is still very difficult. We have to acknowledge this. In civil and social life in Israel, the church is almost totally absent, unlike in Palestinian Authority, whereby it has been accustomed for centuries to relate with the Islamic world, and also through its institutions, especially schools, which play an important role both for preserving the Christian identity and for developing dialogue with the Muslim world, given that many Muslims attend Christian schools. Israel, on the other hand, while making an exception for religious tourism, does not strictly need Catholic Church structure. It's opposite, we need the Israeli structure. Furthermore, the church in Israel is made up largely, as I said, of Arabs, and therefore remains somewhat remote from the Jewish world. Another important topic is that in the Catholic Church, I don't want to be too negative, but I have to say the reality of the things. Another important topic is that in the Catholic Church in general, and even more so in the Holy Land, the existing link in Judaism between the land of Israel, the state of Israel, and Jewish faith is not understood in the same way. On Catholic side, there is a tendency to distinguish between religious faith and the bond with the land and state, while in Judaism, the bond between these realities is profound. And this is also a difference among us. We clearly distinguish what is the relation with the state, which is a political entity, and the Jews as community. But we know very well that for the Jewish, I know, at least living here and with the studies and so on, that the bond between the land of Israel and the Jewish faith is very strong, is unique, you cannot distinguish. And the state of Israel is the place that keep this bond concrete. And this is a difference among us. And if we consider our reality here as a local church where most of the people are Palestinians, you can understand how this is difficult to understand. All this makes a constructive relationship of dialogue at an institutional level difficult, which would otherwise be of great interest and important. Indeed, the church has much in common to share with Israel and its society. We have also positive elements. To give just an example, Christian art is highly appreciated by Jews. Inside Jewish universities, New Testament courses, as we heard from the president of Ben Sasson, are held because Jews are aware that understanding Christianity is essential for understanding Western history, art, literature, and provides the awareness of Europe's Christian roots, but not only. It should be noted that Catholics do not constitute the majority of Christians in Israel. Israeli Jews are not always able to distinguish between Catholic and non-Catholic. Furthermore, most of the ecclesial initiatives in the Holy Land are now organized by all the churches jointly. Although it must be recognized that the approach of Judaism between the different Protestant, Orthodox, and Catholic churches is quite different. In Israel, therefore, dialogue between the Catholic Church and Judaism is not the only channel. Moreover, dialogue initiatives often start from above, that is, from religious leaders, rather from the people who are often very distant from such initiatives. We should ask ourselves if it is not time to leave our conference rooms and do something that is more linked to the territory, with the local initiatives. Furthermore, the role of women in Jewish Christian dialogue is still too small and must be evaluated by the respective religious faith. In this sense, the struggle against male chauvinism and clericalism is still only just beginning with us. We are just at the beginning. Our society is still very, very conservative. In general, Christian churches lament the Jewish-Israeli society's profound ignorance of Christianity and Christians. Still too often, in not few Israeli Jewish circles, Christians are identified as pagans or idol worshippers. On the other hand, it must be recognized that among the Arab, including Christians, knowledge of Judaism is very poor. It must be recognized then that, unfortunately, on the whole, there are not many opportunities for dialogue in Israel, and that often these are not relevant to social life. Religious authorities certainly meet, but in the majority of cases, on formal or institutional occasions, and rarely for strictly religious reasons. Meetings are almost always have no concrete effect at the grassroots level. We are trying, for instance, in these days of distress, of frustration, of our religious tension, to organize a meeting between Jews, Christians, and Muslims, religious leaders, to make a public and common statement, joint statement against any kind of violence in order to calm down the situation. But since this affects directly the life of our people, it's becoming very difficult. We have a lot of resistance to this. I know that something at local level in ACCO, where some problems we had recently, that try to do something at local level, but at general level with the higher authority, top authorities, is becoming very difficult. Nevertheless, at the local level, there is no lack, I want to stress this very important, there is no lack of exemplary and solid situation of dialogue and encounter. We are not that bad after all. Associations, groups, religious and communities that seek to dialogue and encounter are many. We must therefore insist more on those, and there are many, as I repeat, who want a sincere dialogue. In fact, there are numerous friendships and ties between religious communities, movements, and individuals. I give you an example. Before yesterday, 2 days ago, I discovered that there is a Center for Jewish Christian Understanding and Cooperation. They are religious Jews. I insisted, very important element, religious Jews that contacted me because they want to have a list of all the attacks of the some Jews, rabbinical students, yeshiva students against Christian institutions because they want to have a database in order to work against these episodes and make the Israeli society and also the level of the Knesset to be aware that is important to condemn, not only condemn, but work against all these situations. And the initiatives is coming from them, not for us Christians. And they want, they have a complete database that we Christians don't have. This is just one example. Another example, very important. I am a member of Intercultural Jerusalem Center, where Jews, Christians, and Muslims work together for concrete initiatives. And we celebrated the 25 years of the center. And it was very interesting to see. We invite a choir to sing for the celebration. It was a choir of religious Jews who sang in Arabic the Kudus, the holy, 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 Christian Catholic hymn in Arabic. So this just to show that there are many, many initiatives of dialogue encounter here in Israel. So while relations remain formal at the institutional level, numerous dialogue initiatives must be pointed out at the grassroots level are increasing more and more. New ecclesial movement, families who meet for work occasion and then remain linked by sincere friendship, associations and groups for human rights, and many other occasions are often the origin of fraternal ties, which are, to our justification, no less important than the institutional ones. In this sense, an aspect of great hope is constituted by the increasingly frequent visit of Israeli groups in Christian context, holy places, churches, schools, Christian villages, and so on, conferences. In the last year of pandemic, we are being invited to, I don't know how many, dozens of conferences on Christian activities, on Christian life, Christian churches, by Israeli Jewish group movements and associations. This is very, very interesting, very, very nice. In Israel society, in Israeli society, there is more and more awareness of the Christian presence and its cultural contribution to the life of the country. While among Catholics, the life contact with Jews, religious, and otherwise causes many prejudices to fall. We are still in the phase to let prejudices to fall. In Israel, the vast majority of Christians are Arabs, as I know, and they know and fluently use Hebrew. And here we find, in my opinion, a unique challenge in the whole Middle East. Only in Israel do Arab-speaking Christians who know the Hebrew language and who can therefore read the sacred text in Hebrew and dialogue with Jews in their own language. We have only here Arabs can read Hebrew, talk in Hebrew, and access the Old Testament in Hebrew. In this direction, however, there are still many steps to be taken. Often Christian Arabs, as I said, even though they can read the Old Testament in Hebrew, they ignore it. The love for the Old Testament in the local Christian community must therefore grow. They often prefer to leave it aside or not to study it as if it does not matter because it is Jewish. Yet many things are changing. Movement, parish groups, association are progressing in this respect. An important point emerges from this consideration. On the one hand, the Jewish Catholic dialogue in Israel is closely linked to the Christian formation of faithful along the lines of the Second Vatican Council, which not by chance rediscovered its roots with Judaism precisely from its reflection on its own identity. On the other hand, a change of vision and perspective is also needed on Jewish side, which is called to see in the Christian presence and in Christianity a dialogue partner to be known, a constitutive reality of the identity of their country, and not a stranger to be ignored in the best case scenario. This means that serious formation, far from being an obstacle to dialogue, is instead a necessary condition in order to improve our relations. We need to improve our respective formations. In light of what has been said above, very shortly, I now indicate that the topics of the Jewish-Catholic dialogue, which in Israel require, according to me, particular attention for the near future. First, one, the discussion of Jewish identity today in the light of the reconsideration that is open to the future of tradition, of covenant with God, of ethical precepts, of the interpretation of sacred scriptures. We need to dialogue on this topic. Even if it is difficult for our Christian community, we have to start doing this. Second, reflection on the relationship between religion and state, between the religious and civil authorities, the specific reference to the state of Israel. This is a painful topic for our flock, for my community, and we have to deal with this. Our community has to understand, and also our friend Jews should understand the difficulty of my community. Third, relationship of the Jewish people with the Promised Land, an essential topic in the Jewish-Christian dialogue, for which it is necessary to examine the question with reference to the sacred scriptures and its interpretation, to ecclesial and pastoral documents, to the historical messianic significance of the three elements, Torah, people, and land, as I said also before. But also the political repercussion of this consideration have on the life of Palestinian people. For us, for instance, the interpretation of some passages of the Old Testament are very different and will be wonderful. This is my personal experience. It's wonderful to share these differences. Even if we remain different, it's wonderful to understand the different reading of the common scriptures. Four, reflection of the civil rights of minority in the state of Israel for Catholics, also in the light of the diplomatic agreements with the Vatican since 1993, and the commitment to the religious freedom and the protection of the holy places. Five, a common discussion conducted at multiple levels, theological, philosophical, pedagogical, social, political, etc., on topics of peace, is important, reconciliation, non-violence in the three monotheistic religions, at least among us. On the one hand, this commitment aims to demystify the relationship between religion, violence, and political power, and to condemn the violent abuse of religion, fundamentalism, and intolerance. And on the other hand, it aims to strengthen the philosophy and pedagogy of non-violence and their prophetic and educational role in conflict management and the supporting positive political processes bearing witness to the constructive use of religion and its importance as a force of reconciliation. Quite often here, religion is seen as element of division and element that contributes to violence, distinction, and divisions. We have to work on this in order to show that this is an immatriculation religion, but religion can become part of the solution, not only with the problems. Another topic, became important in these days, Jerusalem. I'm not sure in Chicago the Catholics are aware of this. Jerusalem, she has come back to the fore in recent days with the incidents we have all witnessed. Jerusalem is the heart of life of all believers of the monotheistic religions. Already from the biblical period in Judaism, it played a central role, Jerusalem, not just in prayer. It is the heart and the central identity of the people of Israel. I'm aware of this, I understand this. But Jerusalem also played a central role for Christians. The historicity of the Christian faith is made visible precisely by the Holy Land and in particular by Jerusalem, which guards the heart of the Christian revelation. Without a place, there is no event. Without the geography of salvation, we couldn't have the salvation story. Jerusalem is also important for Islam. It is a clear, Jerusalem is a clear, delicate, sensitive issue where our respective jealousies emerge. It's a fact. And it is increasingly necessary that in the dialogue between us, we begin to talk about these two, in order, without denying the respective differences, to seek together a common basis regarding the Holy City, because we have also something in common of prospect of encounter on which to build the future of the city, which, as now and always, will continue to gather us all and to remain the main reference point for our respective faiths and communities. Jerusalem will always remain our heart. We always remain here. So we have to find a way here to have a common basis to share in Jerusalem, and not just to transform the city in a battlefield as it is in nowadays, unfortunately. And this is, for this we need, of course, political leadership, but also religious leadership. Religious leadership is very important. And another point that I want to add, all these problems we are seeing in these days, especially in Israel, because this, the problem with the Gaza and so on is more, mainly politically, but not only. We have to, this is a consequence of policy, if I may say, you can disagree with me, of course, policy of contempt. This violence cannot explode is if there is no behind in the ground something, a kind of distress or frustration that explode in this way, violent way, as we see in this day. And I see that there is especially politics, but not only politics, there is, we are using too much language of contempt against Arab, against Jews, death to Arabs, death to Jews, and so on. And the contempt, the language of contempt, brings sooner or later violence, as we are seeing in these days. And we have to assume responsibilities as religious leaders that we maybe have been not clear enough on this. And we have to work on this, because we have important role. Here, religion is important role. And as long as we don't talk enough for reconciliation, justice, and peace, respect with our differences, and not contempt, if we don't do this, the language of contempt will continue to be spread, and violence to become the only conclusion of this language. So I think this is an important topic we have to raise these days. In conclusion, the Holy Land remains a unique place where the three monotheistic religions, in fact, still coexist, often fragmented, not without real division, within themselves in multiple currents, tradition, and cults. Also, we Christians, as I said, we have a lot of divisions. The three religions, therefore, have a long way to go also with regard to openness to the other within their communities, and not only externally. We cannot talk with Jews, we cannot talk with Muslims, if we don't talk with the Orthodox, the Protestants, and other Christians, of course. So it goes together. This is an essential point. Interreligious dialogue must begin ad intra, within, and if it is to be truly effective, ad extra. Christians who constitute the minority in Holy Land in front of vast Jewish and Muslim community have the important task of being, if I may say, a bridge in a way with the Islamic world, thanks to the many Christians of Arab origin who share with the Muslim majority the language and numerous cultural factors, and with Judaism, thanks also to the small Hebrew Catholic community and many other initiatives, pilgrimage, and many other place of encounters. The different faiths, therefore, if lived in their authenticity, must be bearers of resources of reconciliation and pacification. In this sense, such faith can be an accelerator to foment division or to lead to dialogue. It's up to us. Sooner or later, common religious topics will have to be addressed, which till now have never been discussed. at least never openly, such a relationship with Eretz Israel, the land of Israel, as I've already mentioned. It is an important issue that deserves attention. Leaving politics aside, what is the relationship that the two communities have with the land of Israel from a religious point of view? I think we Christians are very, we lack a very serious religious reflection of the importance of what we call Holy Land, the land of Israel and holy places. It is also important that Catholic, Jewish Catholic goes anyway beyond Western and Middle Eastern borders and begin to look at other geographical, cultural, and religious contexts as well. We are today facing new challenges. The current historical circumstances are once again dramatic and directly question our conscience as believers and questions our faith, that is our relationship with God and consequently our relationship with each other. We are not at the center of a global health. We are now at the center of a global health emergency of tensions and wars, global or not, but still serious and which cross all our societies in the West and East, North and South. Tensions which have often a religious background, or this cannot fail to question each of us, who is not and cannot be an island. Heschel, Abraham Heschel, very important scholar, Jewish scholar, in a very important, pillar article on the interreligious dialogue said, no religion is an island. We cannot work and live as we are an island. We are interconnected and we need to talk about all what affects our respective communities. Up to now, much of our reflection have focused on the past and on the need to purify the memory, to unhinge the wounds, fears, and ancient prejudices that separate us. To begin the dialogue, it is first necessary to recognize each other, and this has been done. We have to keep doing this. This process is not yet complete, but it will continue for a long time. It must always be a constitutive part of our relations. Now, however, and I conclude, to the need to purify the past, there must be added that of collaborating in the future as believers of different faiths, to build models of positive relationship that have clear social repercussions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Your Beatitude, for this rich and thought-provoking talk. Though we are running a bit behind schedule, if it's all right with Your Beatitude, I would like to ask you for some further comments, and perhaps we can take one question as well from the audience. Your Beatitude, before we turn to your paper, I'm wondering whether you might address the current conflict in Israel. Is there anything that you want to say further about the situation, particularly as it pertains to the relationship between various faith groups living in the region?
It's very difficult to in few sentences summarize what you are living. It is an ancient topic, the political Israeli conflict that is never ended, and the wounds are still very painful, especially for Palestinians, of course, that they feel under oppression, under occupation, and they are not ready to give up to their rights, and they feel neglected by international community and also humiliated by the Israeli policy, this government, at least the Israeli policy. This their stand. There is another element that became very evident in these days, Al-Aqsa, what is called Temple Mount or Haram Sharif. This violence has also clear religious tones. And all the people are calling for the liberation of Al-Aqsa, of the mosque in Jerusalem. And this may be the point that is uniting all the different souls of Muslim community, because there are a lot of difference among them. In Israel, they feel the political issue less strong, but Al-Aqsa is uniting them. And the same, of course, of Hamas in Gaza and so on. This is not going to finish soon. It's not going to finish soon, unfortunately. It will be painful. We never saw such a violence in this measure as in these days. It's something new. And we saw here in Jerusalem, there is a question of Sheikh Jarrah, many other things. I don't want to enter on all these things. We saw in Jerusalem a new generation that is ready to fight in a different way. I don't think we are going to see a new intifada, but we are going to see a new kind of resistance to this situation, without a clear political leadership, because the Palestinian political leadership failed. It is not felt as an element of unification among all of them. So, and these are at the grassroots level. And I'm not able to see how this will develop, but for sure we are at the beginning of a new kind of resistance, Palestinian resistance toward Israel. And also Israel now has to decide how to react on the six. It is clear to me that no one can impose solution. No solution can be imposed. No one can. No Palestinians with the attitude, not Israelis, not an international community. Solution can be only find between the parties. As long as they don't talk, I don't see how this is possible to find.
Thank you very much, Your Beatitude. I would now like to address your paper directly, beginning with the topic of education. You note that Jews in Israel do not know very much about Christianity, and that Christians in the region likewise do not know very much about Judaism. What practical steps do you think can be taken which will invite Jews and Christians to learn about one another outside of the political conflict which affects their daily reality?
School. The answer is schools. All go to schools. And we have to create their occasions of encounter, to talk about. I know in Israel there are many schools are doing this. We have to say this. But it's not common at all in all the schools. But we have to start doing this where this is possible. As I said in my presentation, there are a lot of movements, association groups, and so on, but mainly schools. It's important also so that the ministries help the Minister of Education promote this mutual knowledge of each other. This is very important. This is the main way. And it takes a long time, but it's clear to me that we cannot have a very easy and fast solution. We have to build a very long journey of mutual understanding.
Thank you very much. Out of respect for your time, Your Beatitude, I want to ask you whether it's okay to ask a final question or, yes. Okay, thank you very much. Unfortunately, I don't think that we will be able to take the audience questions or comments because it's already 12:15 Chicago time. But I do want to ask you regarding the unique challenges of Jewish-Christian dialogue in the Middle East, in other regions where Jewish-Christian dialogue is robust, especially in the United States, the Catholic Church has played a major role as a trailblazer of Jewish-Christian dialogue. Yet you note that the Catholic Church does not represent the majority of Christians living in Israel and the Palestinian territories, and that the Jewish-Christian relationship in this region goes well beyond the relationship between the Jews and the Catholic Church. Given these demographics, how do you view the role of the Catholic Church as it pertains to the Jewish-Christian relationship in Israel?
Well, Catholic Church in Holy Land is part of the Catholic Church all over the world. We are connected with all the churches. So I think it's important to be in relations with us because this also is a contribution to the general dialogue with all the Catholic churches and vice versa. We have also a lot of connection with the diocese in all over the world and so on. The pilgrimage, even if you are a small presence, there are millions of Christians and Catholics are coming from, not now because of pandemic, but they will come back, coming from all over the world, and they have a very important role. They have to mark the Christian character of the land for us. And so in this way, and this is a very important aspect, and Catholics meet and see a lot of other realities, not just the Catholic holy places. They go also in Yad Vashem, many other places. And this can contribute a lot for the dialogue among us.
Thank you very much, Your Beatitude. I really appreciate these answers. Again, I apologize for our going over and apologize to the audience for not being able to take all of your wonderful comments and questions. But again, out of respect for your time, we're going to move on, and I would like to now invite Dr. Gabriel Esteban, president of DePaul University, to deliver some concluding remarks. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening to those joining us from Israel and other countries from around the world, and good afternoon to our local attendees. It's always an honor for DePaul University to collaborate with our many partners to present the Joseph Cardinal Bernardin Jerusalem Lecture. I'm especially grateful to His Beatitude Patriarch Pizzaballa for delivering this year's keynote lecture. Thank you for sharing your wisdom and insight with us. I also would like to recognize all our speakers who participated in today's program. Sister Barbara Reed, Dr. Menachem Ben Sasson, His Eminence Cardinal Supich, Dr. Malka Sinkovic. I would also like to take this opportunity to echo the sentiments Cardinal Supich shared yesterday, a statement about the violence in Jerusalem. I join him and the Holy Father in a prayer for peace. Next academic year, DePaul University will kick off its quasquicentennial, or 125th anniversary. It will be a year-long celebration to recognize 125 years of giving people of all ethnicities and backgrounds the opportunity to earn a high-quality college education, 125 years of serving first-generation college-going and low-income students, 125 years of being welcoming to all. That's our mission as a Catholic, Vincentian, and urban university to serve the public good. It's also why DePaul has shared a close relationship with Chicago's Jewish community since our founding in 1898. In fact, DePaul was founded to give the children and grandchildren of Jewish and Catholic immigrants the opportunity to pursue an education. When Jews and Catholics didn't have access to higher education, DePaul said, "You are welcome here." For nearly 125 years, we have opened the door to the marginalized and the poor. We have kept asking ourselves, how can we open the door a little wider? At DePaul, we embrace our diversity. We believe our differences strengthen us. That's how we learn from each other and prepare our students to be global citizens who are ready to serve a changing world. Your presence here today, your friendship, means so much to us. We look forward to continuing to learn from one another for the next 125 years. Thank you for joining us, and have a good rest of your day.